Hi, everybody. I'm Jeremiah Blanchard, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about computing fundamentals. So what does it mean when we say computing, anyway? Well, you know, computers hold great potential, but they're very complex. And we need to know what we can do and what are the limits of computation in order to be effective in the discipline. Now, there are many sub-areas of computing. Probably the one most well-known to you is software design and development, where we build a piece of software that other people can use. And a big part of this is programming, but there's many other aspects to computing as well. For example, someone has to design and develop the hardware that we actually run these programs on. Beyond that, building these types of complex projects often requires a specialized process, a way of engineering the software, or software engineering. And this deals with how we work together on teams to build software, among other aspects. Another big part of computing is computational theory. What are the mathematics that tell us what the potential of computing is, and what are its limitations? What are the things we can and cannot do with computing machines? And this is not an exhaustive list, but one thing that all of these have in common is that they're focused on problem solving. In the end, science and engineering are two sides of the same coin. They're two parts of a bigger whole. Science tells us how the systems can work together, how they function, why they function the way that they do. And engineering is how we actually put those things together through some kind of process. So why is computing actually important? Well, as it's put by David Wong in his essay on crack.com, Six Harsh Truths That Will Make You a Better Person, ultimately people need things. We need things in society for society to function. We need things to live our lives and to give them meaning. And the reality is that computing has, and it can in the future, make the world a better place. We can improve life for the people around us, as pointed out in the late Randy Pausch during his last lecture. But in order to do these things, we have to be able to set aside the default for us, what was referred to by the late David Foster Wallace as our default setting. And that's difficult. It's difficult for us to step outside of the things that we've always done and the way that we've always done things. Very little of what we find in life of value is easy. And in this discipline, you're going to fail a lot. And, you know, that's okay. That's normal. Let me tell you a secret. You will fail at life a lot. It's going to happen. But we need to develop resiliency and grit. And these problems that we're solving, these difficult challenges that we run into, they have value. And that means that we're going to have to try a lot of things. And many of the times, those things we try will fail. 90% of the time that I spend even today building hardware or software is failing. It's trying something that doesn't work. And we have to get up and dust ourselves off and go back at it. Okay, so that's my pep talk for you. I'm done now, I promise. But I think it's important for us to recognize the context in which we're trying to solve these kinds of significant challenges. So I've talked at a high level about how important computing is in changing people's lives and making things better. But what's the actual impact of computing? Why are we all doing this? Well, computing touches every aspect of the modern world. We typically communicate by email and on phones and via text messages. Science and research are intricately connected to computer-based models and ways of storing data. Medical practice has reached the point where almost all records are now digitized to make them easily transferable and accessible. Whereas in the past, all of these things were on paper. It's even impacted cultural norms, to the point where we debate and discuss what is the appropriate role of social media. When should we use our phones? When is it impacting social interaction? They impact our political systems. Whenever election season comes around, we see tons of ads for politicians on any side of the spectrum. And of course, they're also trying to dig into those cultural norms that we mentioned before through social media platforms. And they've completely transformed the way that we travel and do commerce, and even whether or not we travel when we do commerce. We can easily engage in video teleconferencing now, whereas before we might have needed to meet someone in person. We buy all sorts of things and book and pay for travel through computing devices. In short, computing has fundamentally changed everything about the way that we live our daily lives. Okay, so where did all this come from? Well, the old school computers, the original, the first computers, they weren't even electrical. In fact, before machines were invented to do these kinds of jobs, It was a human job. Computer was a profession. It wasn't a machine. It was something you did as a job. Like someone might say, oh, I'm an engineer, or I'm a teacher, or I'm a computer. And the job of these folks was to compute, was to crunch numbers all day long, every day. So can you imagine getting to the end of two or three pages of calculations and realizing you made a mistake 3 pages ago? It's hard to fathom today because we have machines that do this for us. But there was a time when that wasn't the case. And when computers finally did come on the scene as devices, as machines, they were mechanical rather than electrical. And what is generally recognized as the first of these is the difference engine, followed soon by the analytical engine. And these were invented and designed by Charles Babbage. Now, while Babbage designed and invented these first physical pieces of hardware, it was another person, Ada Lovelace, who is generally credited as the first programmer. Now, I mentioned that practically every aspect of modern life has been transformed by computing, but I think it's useful to take a look back to an era that was similar to our own but lacked that computing power that we have today. And so I'm going to step back to 1945. By most metrics, if we look at life in 1945, it was fairly modern. People had electricity, running water, they had telephones and television, they even had air travel and modern warfare. But this was an era in which the first digital computer had yet to be completed. And what happened is that computing transformed the way that we actually interact with modern conveniences. So what was missing? Well, the world was a radically different place. First of all, those people I talked about, whose job was computing, computers, they were still a thing in 1945. In fact, in this era was when the first digital computers were finally just starting to appear on the scene. Now, there were some types of repetitive arithmetic that could be done by mechanical tabulating machines, and these were most famously created by IBM International Business Machines, who most of you know also was one of the key players in the home computer revolution. Records were always in some sort of lossy medium, whether that's written down on paper or stamped into vinyl for audio, or on film for video. All of these types of media degrade over time, and we cannot make perfect copies of them, unlike digital content today. Communication was typically very slow, via the postal service, or it was very expensive. You could use a telegraph, or if you were really lucky, you had a home telephone. And there were some people who shared a telephone among several neighbors in a neighborhood. Since there was no real-time form of communication, coordinating meetings meant you set a meeting time and a place well in advance, and you hoped everyone arrived. And if they didn't, you would have to try and figure out why later, because you couldn't just send them a text message. If you were booking travel, that usually meant you would buy tickets at a station or a dock, and you'd do so with cash because that was the only option. As far as commerce, you could do it in person, or you could use a mail order catalog and hope that the item that you paid for arrived. When computers finally arrived on the scene, they filled rooms and they cost millions of dollars. And for that reason, shared computing was the norm. You would have a share of time to use a massive computer, which typically would have some kind of operator. And it involved lots and lots of paper, both input and output. In fact, this is a picture of Margaret Hamilton with the actual code that was used for part of the Apollo missions. She was the head of a software development team. Mistakes, as a result, were extremely costly. You couldn't get that computing time back, which was rare and in demand. So if you made an error in your code, and the computer couldn't process the instructions, that time was lost, and you might have to wait days to run that code again. As a result, generally, this rare and sparse computing power was reserved for researchers in the military, although there were a few lucky souls at universities, like those who were part of the Model Railroad Club at MIT, who had access to these machines. In fact, you may not know it, but this is where the term hacker came from. The Model Railroad Club members referred to modifying their model railroad system as hacking the system. And because they were also some of the earliest university students to have access to these types of systems, that language eventually made it into developer parlance. So what about computing today? Today, much of our technology is inspired by science fiction, but made possible by computing. For example, the first smartphones appeared in the original Star Trek series, where they were called communicators. Handheld sensors, which we have in each of our phones today, also appeared on Star Trek. Smartwatches first appeared in the Jetsons. Autonomous vacuums appeared in the Jetsons. Video chat was also the Jetsons, and to some degree Star Trek. I guess you could debate which one really takes the claim here. AI assistants showed up in 2001 A Space Odyssey, although you could also make a claim here for Star Trek, I think. Digital billboards, we saw these in Blade Runner. And tablets also first appeared in Star Trek. In essence, computing has allowed us to take what were only dreams for previous generations and turn them into reality for ourselves. With that said, if we look to the horizon, if we look ahead, what's next? Well, of course, if I knew that, I'd be rich. But there's a few places that seem likely. Autonomous vehicles, as envisioned by Total Recall, among others, seem to be on the cusp of reality. Robust voice recognition, you may even argue, is here, but it's definitely closer today than it's ever been before. And we saw that in the computers of Star Trek. Brain-computer interfaces, in the vein of the Matrix, are in their infancy, but they do exist, particularly for those who are paralyzed, and in some cases to correct vision. Pervasive augmented reality, as proposed in Den No Coil, also appears to be tantalizingly close. Robotic prostheses and organs, as posited by Niccolo, also appear to be close at hand. And finally, edge computing, also known as the Internet of Things, is slowly growing into everything that we do. Now, any of these, or all of them, may be missing the mark. But there are opportunities out there. There are ways that we can make our fellow human beings' lives better. And that's really the reason that we do what we do. And that is the ultimate power of the computing professions.